Good afternoon. Can I start by reminding colleagues of the COVID-related measures and that face coverings should be worn while moving around the Chamber and the wider Holyrood campus? The next item of business is portfolio questions, and on this occasion the portfolio is Constitution, External Affairs and Culture. As ever, if a member wishes to ask a supplementary, I'd invite them to press the request to speak buttons or place an R on the chat function during the relevant question. And I call question number one, Faisal Chowdhury.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what discussion it has had regarding how its international development programme can help to support less developed countries that are at the forefront of climate change.
Minister Neil Gray.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. Our Climate Justice Fund supports communities on the front line of the global climate emergency at COP26. The First Minister committed to treble the fund to £36 million over this Parliament and to provide support for loss and damage. The floods in Malawi following Storm Anna highlight the damaging impacts of extreme weather events on climate vulnerable communities, and we've been communicating with the Government of Malawi on the floods, and we're currently exploring the most appropriate means of support for those affected.
Faisal Chowdhury.
Thank you very much. I would like to say congratulations to Neil for his new post, and we are missing him from the Social Justice and Social Security Committee. I hope you'll do your job as well as you've been doing with us in the committee. The UN World Food Programme has estimated nearly 13 million people in the Horn of Africa are facing severe hunger with drought conditions, having affected pastoral and farmer population across southern and southeastern Ethiopia, southeastern and northern Kenya and south central Somalia, and many now becoming climate refugees. Can I ask the Scottish Government what new engagement has the Government had with the UK Government about sharing information and technology for farming and adaptations, not just to the Horn of Africa, but to our partner countries like Zambia and Malawi, who have also suffered to the effects of climate change?
Minister.
I thank Faisal Chowdhury for his kind words at the start. Flattery will get him everywhere, and it's greatly appreciated. Clearly, we have a commitment with our partner countries, but our commitment to international development and our climate justice work doesn't just stop there, and we're keen to do whatever we can within the powers that we have to be able to support those initiatives worldwide. And obviously, if we can support that through the work that the UK Government is doing, then we will do.
A couple of supplementary. First, Kenneth Gibson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I welcome the Minister to his post. I'm delighted that United Nations Children's Organisation UNICEF is to receive £1.5 million from the Scottish Government, as announced today, to support equitable access to COVID-19 vaccines and therapeutics in Rwanda, Zambia and Malawi. Does the Minister agree that Scotland could do so much more if powers over international aid and development were with this Parliament, ran with a UK Government which has broken its own manifesto commitment to invest 0.7% of national income in helping the world's poorest nations?
Minister.
Yes, and I thank Mr Gibson for that question. The Scottish Government believes the cutting of ODA spending from 0.7% to 0.5% of GNI was a deplorable decision that has hit the world's poorest and most marginal communities at a time of huge need, as we've already heard. We will continue to urge the UK Government to reinstate spending of 0.7% of GNI as soon as possible. In contrast to the UK Government, we have committed to not only maintain, but in fact increase our international development budget by 50% to £15 million over the course of this Parliament, as well as trebled our support to climate justice. And this statement of intent highlights how much more we could do with the powers of independence.
And Maurice Golden.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. And on behalf of these benches, I welcome the Minister to his post. Improving waste management in developing countries not only helps tackle climate change, but also helps improve sanitation and lower health-harming pollution levels. Historically, waste management has attracted very little support, with UN figures show it got just 0.32% of global funds. Does the Minister agree with me that there is an opportunity for Scotland to take a lead by targeting our support in a space that is often ignored?
Minister.
Yes, I do, and I thank Maurice Golden for that question, and I'd be happy to engage with him further on that issue and any ideas he has for how we can support that further.
Thank you. Question number two, Jim Fairley.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'd like to ask the Scottish Government what engagement it has had with the UK Government regarding the potential impact on Scotland of the proposed Brexit Freedoms Bill.
Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. We've had no meaningful engagement with the UK Government on the Brexit Freedoms Bill. I spoke with the UK Attorney General just 2 days prior to the UK Government announcement. The meeting gave a clear impression of being for no other purpose than to allow the UK Government to say that discussions had taken place with the devolved governments, when in fact what was on offer was a vague verbal briefing with nothing in writing and no advance briefing of any sort. This was totally inadequate given the sweeping changes that are proposed in law, including law in devolved areas. The approach taken by the UK Government is all the more galling for its proximity to the publication of the Intergovernmental Relations Review. It runs completely counter to the principles set out clearly in the review of mutual respect for the responsibilities of the governments and for building and maintaining trust based on effective communication.
Tim Fairley.
I'd like to thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer, and I have to say I share his concerns. But does he share my concern that this bill is in fact just another method, if anyone needed, to undermine the legitimacy of this Parliament's role in carrying out what it was democratically elected to do? Areas specifically around the agricultural and subsidy control element of the bill have the potential to make it much harder for this Parliament to deliver the policies that work best for Scotland's farmers.
Cabinet Secretary.
Indeed, I do share this concern that the bill risks undercutting this Parliament's powers, this Parliament's responsibilities, although the precise provisions of the Brexit Freedom Bill have not yet been published. Based on UK Government recent behaviour, I remain concerned that Scotland's world-leading animal welfare and environmental standards will be undermined. For example, we know the UK Government was willing, in a recent free trade agreement with Australia, to grant Australian agri-food exporters significant market access to the Scottish agriculture market whilst producing a lower animal welfare and environmental standards, therefore undercutting our own domestic producers. Turning to the question of subsidy control, an effective subsidy control regime should promote a fair business landscape while facilitating targeted and effective support. The regime proposed in the Subsidy Control Bill is asymmetrical, giving sweeping powers to the UK sector state with no equivalent powers for devolved administrations. It may also disproportionately restrict agricultural subsidies, which may wish to offer in Scotland in future.
Thank you. And a supplementary from Sarah Boyack.
Thank you very much, Deputy Presiding Officer. Can I follow up that issue with the Cabinet Secretary, given the potential impact of this bill on the Scottish Parliament's competences? Can the Cabinet Secretary provide an update on whether he's been able to have a conversation with the UK Government on this particular issue, given that we now have these new intergovernmental relations theoretically in place? Has he asked for a meeting? And it would be certainly very useful for us to get some feedback on progress so that we can have transparency and be able to look at this bill as it comes forward.
Not only has our unhappiness been conveyed to the UK Government, but significantly, the level of agreement that exists between this SNP-led government in the Scottish Parliament, the Welsh-led government in Wales, and in Northern Ireland, both DUP and Sinn Féin ministers are all in agreement on this. We sat incredulous in a meeting with the UK Attorney General, acting at complete variance to the assurances, the agreement that had been announced only weeks earlier. And I have pointed out that it's fine and well to have agreements in principle about how intergovernmental relations should work. However, if the mindset doesn't change, it's not going to improve relations. So yes, we've communicated it to the UK government, and yes, we're working very well and very closely with colleagues in Wales and Northern Ireland of all political persuasions to make sure that the UK government hears loud and clear that its approach is totally and utterly unacceptable and has to change.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. I'm conscious we've got a bit of time over the course of the afternoon, but I would appreciate slightly tighter questions and slightly more succinct answers from the ministerial team. Question number three, Mark Griffin, who joins us remotely.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what discussions it has had regarding how its international development programme can support the sharing of vaccines, help to tackle the reported vaccine apartheid in the Global South.
Minister.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. On the 8th of December, the First Minister wrote to the Prime Minister to urge the UK Government to join over 100 countries who are now supportive of a temporary trade-related aspects of intellectual property rights waiver for COVID-19 vaccines. By waiving patent protection for COVID-19 vaccines, countries will be able to make use of all the tools available to increase vaccine access. And as we have just announced today, the Scottish Government have provided international development funding to support vaccine preparedness and delivery in Malawi, Zambia and Rwanda. This includes a £2 million contribution in December 2020 and a further £1.5 million this financial year.
Thank you. Mark Griffin.
Thank the Minister for that answer. He'll be aware that the proportion of people fully vaccinated in Rwanda is 54%. However, in Zambia, it is 9%, and Malawi stands at just 4%. Those are the Scottish Government partner countries that the Minister mentions who should, and I think we'll look forward to receiving that additional support. So can I ask the Minister if he engages with the authorities there on the reasons for such a slow rollout, and specifically how many vaccines have been shared with those countries?
Minister.
Yes, we're in constant discussion with our partner countries on these issues, which is why it's been identified that this support would be welcome. And we continue that support, but again, I reiterate, and this is an early priority for me, that we make sure that we enhance the vaccine equity support going on worldwide, and we build on the leadership that has been shown by the First Minister in regards to the UK Government joining up with a waiver on vaccine intellectual property.
Okay, brief supplementary from Sharon Dowie.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and can I also welcome Neil Gray into his new position. The announcement of funding to Malawi, Zambia and Rwanda is welcome, but could I ask if the Scottish Government could give us an update on other aid that's been promised? In October, the Scottish Government pledged £120,500 from its humanitarian aid fund that would go to help South Sudan's Unity State, which suffered flooding across 90% of its territory. Could the Minister update us on how much of the funding has been spent in South Sudan and how it has been sent, given recent press articles saying
Minister.
Thanks, Andrew, for that question. I will be happy to update her in writing on the work that has been done via the Humanitarian Aid Fund.
Thank you. Question number four, Monica Lennon.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what discussions it has had with National Records of Scotland and other organisations on the challenges facing people affected by historic forced adoption when seeking to access records.
Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. The Scottish Government and its officials have had discussions with a number of organisations involved in adoption records. These include the National Records of Scotland as part of our initial engagement activities around historical adoption practices. The Scottish Government is determined to improve the experience of those affected by adoption, and access to records is one of the number of areas that we are exploring. We're seeking a broad range of views and want to learn more about the impacts as we progress with our engagement. The information we receive will help inform how we support those affected by these practices.
Monica Lennon.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for his response and that helpful update, and also welcome Neil Gray to his post. As the Minister and the Cabinet Secretary know, it's estimated that around 60,000 mothers in Scotland had their babies taken from them due to historic forced adoption practices. And for many years, the campaigners have been fighting for justice, including a long overdue formal apology, specialist mental health support and, of course, better access to records. I'm glad the Cabinet Secretary is aware that there are real difficulties for mothers, fathers and adoptees to access information and records. Will the Minister meet with me and some campaigners who want to bring some additional information to his attention and other MSPs who have an interest and commit to doing all that he can to urgently improve access to records and information?
Cabinet Secretary.
Delighted to meet with Monica Lennon and campaigners on the issue, and I'm sure between her office and mine we can find a suitable date as soon as possible. The Scottish Government have already opened discussions with a number of organisations, including Birthlinks, the National Records of Scotland and a number of adoption agencies through the Social Work Scotland Fostering and Adoption Subgroup. We'll continue to meet with them as we seek to expand on our understanding of this very complex and multifaceted issue, and meeting with the campaigners that Monica Lennon has raised, I think, will be a good addition to that process. This is a long-standing issue. It is a complicated issue. I hope there is agreement right across the chamber that we need to find remedies for this. We want to do that as quickly as possible, and I'm happy to be advised by colleagues of all political parties about how best we can do that.
And supplementary, Miles Briggs.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. And can I associate myself with what Monica Lennon has already said? But I think it's also important for campaigners that we look at the progress of this work being progressed by the Scottish Government as well. And I hope that's something ministers take on board. But can I specifically ask, with regards to a national record of historical forced adoption experiences, is that something ministers are already looking at? And when will we likely see announcements on that work, which campaigners really want to see progressed as soon as possible?
Cabinet Secretary.
I commend a colleague from the Conservative benches raising the issue of progress, because it has waited a long time for people to see the progress that they would want to see. I hope he understands that the complexities of the issue are such that it is simply not possible to say there is a fix to the situation as we find ourselves in. We are moving as quickly as we possibly can. We are trying to find the remedies across the piece. There are all kinds of complications involved with the process, but I agree with him. It cannot go on endlessly without finding resolution for people. I'm happy to work with him and colleagues across the chamber so that they are fully apprised of what stage we're at and when we are likely to be able to make announcements. And I'm happy to update him and continue to do that as we make progress in this important area.
Thank you. Question number 5, Douglas Lumsden.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what legal advice it has received on introducing the proposed referendum bill on Scottish independence.
Cabinet Secretary.
The Scottish Government does not comment on the content or source of legal advice. Other than in exceptional circumstances, government legal advice is not released and remains confidential. This reflects the public interest in the provision of free and frank legal advice, maintaining the right to confidentiality of communications between legal advisers and clients. The law officers advise the government about any bill which ministers introduce. This is recognised in the Scottish Ministerial Code in paragraphs 2.41 and 3.4.
Douglas Lumsden.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Once again, we hear of vast sums of taxpayers' money being wasted on planning for another divisive independence referendum, despite the fact that no Section 30 agreement is in place with the United Kingdom Government. And this devolved government can't even share with us if they have been told if this non-Section 30 independence referendum is legal or not. This Parliament is once again being left in the dark about what advice this devolved government has had or how much they're spending on it. The government spends more on hiring civil servants to plan a referendum than they spend on raising attainment for pupils in Aberdeen. When will the Cabinet Secretary get his priorities right and start focusing on the day job?
Cabinet Secretary.
Forgive me, Deputy Presiding Officer, but I'm not going to take lectures by a political party that lost the election on this very issue. Something that the member should know something about, having stood on a manifesto commitment opposing a referendum in 2019 and losing to the Scottish National Party, which was committed for one to take place. And supplemental to that, in the very same constituency in last year's election, who won the election there? Again, it was the Scottish National Party. Excuse me? Being heckled from a sedentary position.
You have, and you shouldn't
difficult.
Respond to it, Cabinet Secretary. Hold on, can you resume your seat? I appreciate that emotions run high on this topic. I would appreciate if those who are asking questions would then allow the ministerial team to respond without sedentary interventions. But, Cabinet Secretary, I'd also encourage you to stick to answering the question that's on the order paper. Okay?
Indeed. And I've made the position clear in terms of legal advice, but there's a basic democratic principle in all of this, Deputy Presiding Officer, which is when the public elects a party to govern, they expect them to deliver on the manifesto commitments they have made. This government was elected with a commitment to hold a referendum about the future of Scotland. And on this issue, surprisingly, the Conservative Party wants the government not to deliver on its manifesto commitments. A very odd set of priorities.
And a supplementary from Stuart McMillan.
Thank you very much, Deputy Presiding Officer. Can the Cabinet Secretary reiterate to those who do seem determined to overlook the firm democratic will of the Scottish people the ways in which the Scottish Government has secured a clear and overwhelming mandate to hold an independence referendum within the first half of this Parliament, and does he agree that the Scottish people should expect an open, bold and honest conversation around the opportunities of independence ahead of the referendum?
Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you very much, Deputy Presiding Officer. The agreement reached between the Scottish Government and the Scottish Green Party confirms and strengthens the clear mandate granted by the people of Scotland for a referendum on Scottish independence. 72 of 129 members of the Scottish Parliament were elected on manifestos that commit them to a referendum of Scottish independence during this Parliament. A Section 30 order has already been mentioned in the Chamber. I think it behoves the UK Government to respect the democratic wishes of the people in an election who returned a government. Deputy Presiding Officer, we are seeing interventions from a sedentary position which seek to disrespect the results of a democratic election. This government is committed to delivering what the people voted for, and they elected a majority of MSPs to this chamber, whether gentlemen and honourable ladies on those benches don't recognise that. On these benches we do. We will deliver on the mandate that was delivered by the Scottish people.
Can I again encourage members not to make interventions from a sedentary position, but I can also encourage ministers to ignore any sedentary interventions should they be made. Question number six, Alec Rowley.
Presiding Officer, to ask the Scottish Government what impact Brexit has had on its policies across government, including how it invests in business.
Cabinet Secretary.
The UK Government's determination to impose a hard Brexit against the democratic wishes of the people of Scotland has caused significant impacts across society. One of the hardest hit has been businesses, who are continuing to be faced by trade friction, additional checks and increased administration costs. The Scottish Government supports and invests in businesses in a vast range of ways. Brexit is making it harder for those policies to achieve their objectives and deliver positive outcomes for Scotland because of the permanent damage it is inflicting on our economic relationship with the European Union.
Alec Rowley.
Thank you. Can I ask the Cabinet Secretary, is there any legal or constitutional reason that would explain the failure of the Scottish Government to set up the proposed and promised National Energy Company? And why couldn't they have made much more use of the powers they currently have to ensure that Scotland benefited from the onshore manufacturing and services needed to supply the offshore wind farms? So is there any legal or constitutional reason that would explain why the Scottish Government did not seek legal guarantees that this work would come to Scotland?
Cabinet Secretary.
Deputy Presiding Officer, I'm sure you would chide me for not sticking with the question that was posed. And Alex Rowley raises an important question, but it's not related to the initial question that he asked. On legal and constitutional relations with the European Union, I think members on all sides of this House know that we have an opportunity in this country in the next years to make a decision about whether we rejoin the European Union, become part of the biggest single market in the world. Yep. And I hope that Alex Rowley and colleagues will join us in agreeing that the people should be able to decide on that question, even although we may disagree on the vote that might take place in that referendum. I hope we are agreed as Democrats on the constitutional legal position that having elected a parliament and a government to deliver that the people should have a vote, the people should have that vote.
Question number seven, Siobhan Brown.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can I ask the Scottish Government how it is building on Scotland's relations with the EU post-Brexit?
Cabinet Secretary.
Scotland remains an inclusive European nation. We share with the European Union a vision for Europe that embodies democratic values, rises to the challenge of the global climate emergency, and supports sustainable economic recovery from the global pandemic. The Scottish Government continues to take a proactive role in engaging with EU institutions and member states, particularly through our Brussels office and external European network. We recognise the importance of learning from others and sharing experiences across Europe. Later this spring, we will open a new Scottish Government office in Copenhagen to further strengthen our EU ties and increase Scotland's economic and cultural connections with the Nordic region.
Siobhan Brown.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer. Some of my constituents, particularly students, have been in touch as they are acutely starting to feel the effects of the UK's hard approach to EU relations post-Brexit, including through the loss of the Erasmus Student Exchange Programme. Can the Cabinet Secretary provide any update on the Scottish Government's efforts to set up an alternative which will benefit students in Scotland and across Europe?
Cabinet Secretary.
It's disappointing that the UK Government's decision not to associate to Erasmus Plus currently prevents Scotland from participating fully in its own right. While we remain committed to Erasmus Plus in the interim, we are creating a Scottish Education Exchange programme to support participants from across Scotland's education system. This is a programme for government commitment and will help maintain Scotland's place as an outward-looking, internationally connected destination, both for work and for study.
And question number 8 from Joe Fitzpatrick, who joins us remotely.
To ask the Scottish Government what its response is to reported calls for the head of the civil service to investigate and rule on the deployment of Scottish Government civil servants to develop policy on independence.
Cabinet Secretary.
It's quite clearly the duty of the civil service to support the elected government of the day to develop and implement its policies, including those relating to the Constitution. This is widely accepted, including by previous heads of the UK Civil Service. Members will also have seen a former member of this chamber, Professor Adam Tompkins, tweeting to accept that this is a proper role for the civil service.
Joe Fitzpatrick.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that response. Would he agree with me that this political stunt is an embarrassing and hypocritical attempt to thwart Scottish democracy on the part of a political party whose leader just a couple of weeks ago accused the Prime Minister of treating Scotland with utter disdain?
Cabinet Secretary.
I agree with my colleague, the member for Dundee West, as is the case across the government's programme. The civil service will support Scottish ministers in delivering commitments in the programme for government. We should not forget that in 2011, the then head of the UK civil service, Sir Gus O'Donnell, said, and I quote him, "It is right and proper that civil servants working to their respective administrations undertake the relevant work to support their ministers to pursue their aims, whether or not those aims are subject of political controversy," when writing to party leaders on this very topic.
And a brief supplementary from Donald Cameron.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. A recent FOI revealed the Scottish Government has 11 civil servants working on an independence prospectus at a reported cost of £700,000 a year. Can the Cabinet Secretary confirm how many staff, civil servant staff, are working on the independence referendum bill? And will he confirm how much this is costing taxpayers?
Cabinet Secretary.
Forgive me, I didn't get any advance notice of the detailed question that Donald Cameron just asked. I'm happy to write back from him. I hope he doesn't disagree with the accepted notion across political parties that governments are there to deliver what they have been elected to do. That is what we intend to do, and that is exactly what will happen during this parliamentary term.
Thank you. That concludes portfolio questions. It's time to move on to the next item of business, and there'll be a brief pause while front benches change.